My name is Dr. Melody Russell, and I'm a resident physician in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology. This presentation is entitled Placenta Previa. The learning objectives of this presentation are to understand the definitions, epidemiology, and risk factors for placenta previa, to review clinical manifestations of placenta previa and associated conditions, and to discuss the management of asymptomatic and symptomatic placenta previa. We will begin by reviewing definitions relevant to placenta previa, followed by discussion of the pathogenesis, risk factors, and epidemiology of placenta previa. Lastly, we will review diagnosis and management. Placenta previa describes a situation in which the placenta is overlying or near the internal cervical os. This occurs in one of 300 deliveries. First, let's review the classifications for placenta previa. Marginal previa is when the placenta is immediately adjacent to the internal cervical os but does not cover it. In a complete previa, the placenta covers the entire internal cervical os. Of complete previas, 20 to 30% are central previas, in which the os is equidistant from the anterior and posterior edges of the placenta. Lastly, a low-lying placenta is one in which the placenta is within 2 centimeters of the internal cervical os. Next, we will review proposed pathogenetic mechanisms and associated risk factors for placenta previa. Conditions that cause endometrial scarring increase the risk of placenta previa. Endometrial scarring may allow for trophoblastic invasion into the lower uterine segment. Risk factors for scarring include prior cesarean delivery, increasing parity, and prior curettage. Increasing demand for utero-placental exchange is another proposed mechanism for previa, as this may result in the need for increasing placental surface area. Associated risk factors include maternal smoking, high altitude, and multiple gestation. The incidence of placenta previa is 1 in 300 deliveries. The incidence of previa in early gestational age is 5 to 15% of all deliveries. And prior cesarean section incidence is 1 to 4%. Other risk factors for placenta previa include advancing maternal age, early gestational age, male fetus, maternal race, and elevated maternal serum alpha fetoprotein. The classic clinical presentation for placenta previa is painless vaginal bleeding. A significant minority of patients present with uterine contractions accompanied by vaginal bleeding. Symptoms occur in the third trimester as the lower uterine segment develops and uterine contractions start to cause cervical change. As the cervix dilates and defaces, the lower uterine segment develops. This produces shearing forces that cause the placenta to shear and bleed. Placenta previa is associated with other abnormal placentation, which we will review momentarily, as well as fetal malpresentation, preterm premature rupture of membranes, fetal growth restriction, vasa previa, which is vessels presenting at the cervical os, velamentous cord insertion, congenital anomalies, and amniotic fluid embolism. Placenta accreta occurs with 5 to 10% of all placenta previa. Placenta accreta occurs due to abnormal placental implantation when placental villi attach to the myometrium, resulting in an abnormally adherent placenta. Increta occurs when chorionic villi invade the myometrium, and placental percreta occurs when chorionic villi penetrate the uterine serosa and may involve surrounding organs such as the bladder, as shown in the ultrasound image. Placenta previa is included in the differential diagnosis for third trimester bleeding. Other conditions that cause third trimester bleeding include placental abruption, which is a premature separation of the placenta from the uterus, vasa previa, when fetal vessels course the internal cervical os, uterine rupture, and lastly, vaginal, cervical, or uterine pathology. The diagnosis of placenta previa is made by localizing the placenta on diagnostic imaging. Transabdominal ultrasound is the safest, simplest, and most accurate way to localize the placenta. Transvaginal ultrasound is safe and offers excellent visualization of the internal cervical os. Transperineal sonography is reported to be accurate, but is not routinely used for placental localization. Magnetic resonance imaging is not routinely used for placental localization, but is often used when there is a strong suspicion for accreta based on ultrasound findings. Magnetic resonance imaging findings suggestive of accreta are uterine bulging, heterogeneous signal intensity within the placenta, and the presence of dark intraplacental bands. Now we will review management of placenta previa. Asymptomatic patients with placenta previa are followed with repeat ultrasounds through the third trimester, as the placenta may become farther from the internal cervical os as the uterus expands and the lower uterine segment develops. These patients are instructed to continue pelvic rest and that nothing should be put in the vagina. This includes vaginal intercourse as well as digital cervical examinations by their physician. After an episode of vaginal bleeding, patients are hospitalized for close inpatient monitoring. If they are stable and have no further bleeding for several days, they may be discharged. Before discharge, patients must understand that they should be able to reliably return to the hospital quickly should they develop further vaginal bleeding. Importantly, the plan is contingent on gestational age, as it may be more prudent to move toward delivery after a significant bleed if the patient is over 34 weeks, while conservative management is preferred in earlier gestational ages given the risks of morbidity associated with premature birth. In the setting of acute vaginal bleeding, patients must have adequate IV access, often two large bore IVs, in case aggressive resuscitation is required. Patients should receive antenatal steroids to promote fetal lung maturity if they are less than 34 weeks gestational age, as delivery may be imminent depending on the severity of the hemorrhage. A blood type and antibody screen should be obtained for Rh status, as patients should receive Rh immune globulin after the initial bleed if they are Rh negative. This should also be sent in anticipation of possible blood transfusion if required. The fetus should be monitored continuously, as any signs of non-reassuring fetal status suggest fetal anemia and/or hypoxemia. Ultimately, providers should move toward delivery if fetal status is non-reassuring despite resuscitative measures, if hemorrhage is life-threatening, if the patient is in active labor, or if significant bleeding occurs after 34 weeks gestational age. Cesarean delivery is necessary in nearly all women with placenta previa. In the case of placenta accreta, special precautions should be taken as there is a very significant chance of hemorrhage at the time of surgery. These precautions include preoperative arterial catheter placement for possible uterine artery embolization, coordination with the blood bank for transfusion services, and consultation with gynecologic oncology for surgical assistance if cesarean hysterectomy is required. In conclusion, placenta previa occurs when there is abnormal placental implantation at or near the internal cervical os. It classically presents with painless vaginal bleeding and is diagnosed by imaging with ultrasound and magnetic resonance imaging follow-up if necessary when there is concern for placenta accreta. Placenta previa can be managed as an outpatient if the patient is asymptomatic or after one episode of bleeding. Active bleeding in placenta previa should be considered a potential obstetric emergency. Mode of delivery should be by cesarean section.